Today's news show is brought to you by The District on Kernan, where life happens.
Good evening, Ospreys, and thanks for watching. I'm Chelsea Kingsmill, and this is your OTV News. New developments in a story we first brought you last month. UNF turned over all the documents that Governor Rick Scott was seeking in the letters he sent out on October 13th. The 11 public state universities had until November 15th to do this. According to the letters, the information will provide Scott with information he needs to make a policy change regarding education funds towards science, technology, engineering, and math, STEM degrees.
I think STEM is important for economic growth. There's no doubt about it. We would be better off if we had more students graduating in STEM fields. But we also need students who graduate out of the arts, we need students who graduate out of communications, we need students who graduate from all those fields. It would be nice to grow the proportion of engineers and computer students and mathematicians and science students.
To view the original letters in their entirety, check out OspreyTV.com. Florida's 11 public universities could receive less funding in the future if the University of South Florida Polytechnic becomes the 12th university. Matt Head has more.
USF's Polytechnic separation from USF is creating concerns among state university student body presidents, including UNF's Matt Brockelman.
It could have an impact on the other 11. Right now, as we all know, our tuition is going up, state support for universities is going down. If we can't properly support 11, how are we going to do it with 12?
The idea is as simple as it sounds. The USF Polytechnic is a branch of USF campus. The school is located in Lakeland, Florida. Last week, the Board of Governors agreed that the USF campus must meet particular benchmarks before becoming independent. The school must seek accreditation and provide students with the opportunity to graduate from USF if they so choose. This would allow them to become Florida's only polytechnic university.
It's met a lot of opposition, and it kind of stems from, STEM no pun intended, it comes from the governor and the state legislature pushing for STEM degrees, which is science, technology, engineering, and math.
Rick Scott outlined his plans in letters to the state university presidents for increased interest in STEM degrees. He believes they would provide a boost to Florida's jobs. In a statement from the Florida Board of Governors, Ava Parker said, "These benchmarks ensure the development of a STEM-focused institution that will meet the growing demand for jobs in our state. The Board of Governors is committed to the support and oversight required to ensure the success of the university." But where does the money trail lead?
So it might not be that our budgets get cut directly because of a 12th university, but it definitely could be any future funds that we could get would be foregone because the money would be diverted elsewhere. So it's kind of, we have to be careful. We can't necessarily say that we'll get cut because of it. We might not increase because that increase might go to Polytechnic instead.
For your OTV News, I'm Matt Head.
The FSA president, Michael Long, was called out during the Board of Governors meeting last week by Senator J.D. Alexander. Alexander is one of the largest supporters of USF Polytechnic becoming an independent campus. We will continue to follow this story as it develops on our website, OspreyTV.com. The Florida Board of Governors will have a new strategic plan that is expected to last through 2025. In a release from the BOG, they voted to implement a new strategic plan for the new year through 2025. This plan is created to be based off excellence, productivity, and strategic priorities. Some of the goals set by this plan are to increase annual graduation rate with a four-year degree from the now 53,000 to 90,000 by 2025. We did the math, and this is an increase of 88.7% over this span of time. They also hope to increase community involvement across the 11 institutions in the state university system and to come up with more research and development licensing rights. To view this information in its entirety, you can visit the website on your screen. On page 19, you will find the strategic plan goals in detail. According to a review of university salaries conducted by the Post, university administrative salaries in Florida are considerably higher than other states. State University System Chancellor Frank Brogan explains in an interview with the Post, Florida tries to attract the best of the best with the high salaries without going overboard. The Florida legislature cut public funding by 17% between 2007 and 2010. From the review, it appears most of the budget is still going towards administrative salaries. Per the Post, median salaries at some large Florida universities are ranging from $203,694 to $315,000. Brogan says we need to stay away from making assumptions about salary and compensation packages based on irregularity in the numbers. In other news, the University of Florida is being sued after failing to produce records of 33 primates involved in research. According to Jacksonville and Gainesville.com, the founder of the animal rights group, negotiation is over. Camille Marino wants information that includes veterinary records as well as the details about the primates' deaths. UF officials are fighting back by citing a state law that protects the confidentiality of vet patient records. 8th Judicial Circuit Chief Judge Martha Ann Lott served UF with an order last week to respond within a 20-day period about the research records. If you've been on campus at night, you may have noticed the lights around the lake in front of the student union. The first Light Up the Lake took place Tuesday at 5:30 p.m. The Perfect Fifths and the UNF Women's Chorale from the Department of Music Flagship Program performed as the lights lit the trees surrounding the lake. This is a new tradition for UNF and is sponsored by the Intercultural Center for Peace to celebrate peace and unity. The lights will remain lit until mid-January. There are some showers in our area this morning. Wondering if these conditions will continue into your weekend plans? Here is Cece Aguilar with your weather forecast.
Thanks, Chelsea. Hey Ospreys, I'm Cece Aguilar and this is your OTV forecast. After a warm week, let's check out your chance of rain for the upcoming weekend. Today we have a 0% chance of rain with a nice breeze, and tomorrow we also have a 0% chance of rain during the day, and then later on tomorrow night there will be about a 20% chance of rain. That rain will carry over into Saturday, where we will also have a 20% chance of rain with a slight chance for showers and thunderstorms. And then on Sunday and Monday, we will go back down to about a 0% chance of rain. Now let's check out our 5-day forecast. Today we have clear skies and a slight breeze around 77 degrees and a low tonight around 49. Tomorrow it will stay breezy with a cooler high around 65 and a chance for showers and thunderstorms throughout the night. Saturday we are looking at a high around 75 with very cloudy skies. Sunday looks like we'll have partly cloudy skies and our high near 78. And then on Monday, we will also have a high near 78 with mostly sunny skies. Those showers that we will be having Friday through Saturday will be moving southeast and across northeast Florida. This will result in an elevated risk of rip currents for the weekend. Take extra precaution when going to the beach. Remember, for your latest updates on weather, check out OspreyTV.com and follow us on Twitter. For your OTV News, I'm Cece Aguilar.
Thanks, Cece. The University of North Florida's mock trial organization returns to campus with multiple awards. The UNF mock trial, composed of two teams, traveled to Gainesville this past weekend to attend the second annual UF Growlin Gator Invitational Competition. Competing against rivals, UNF received the most individual awards of all universities that attended, and as a whole won matches against UF, USF, and UCF. With the end of the semester near, students are reviewing their professors and wondering what class would be like with a fantasy professor.
Ever wish Newton could explain your physics homework to you? Or daydream John Lennon teaching music theory? We asked 150 students what celebrity, living or dead, they'd choose as a UNF professor.
I would pick Jimi Hendrix because he was just like a musical pioneer, just explored new ways to play music and like really progressed rock and roll, and I'm a musician, so.
And Maximus, because he's an awesome fighter and he would destroy anybody who spoke up in his class, and he would teach art. Yeah, okay. So if he didn't like their piece, he'd just like kick him in the face.
I think a great professor at UNF would be Jesus, because I follow his teachings, and he's very clear and direct and humble, so it's somebody that I like to listen to. He would teach how to be humble in the world that we live in.
Einstein and Jesus tied for most popular choice with 15.3% each. Lil Wayne came in second, losing by only one vote. Overall, students prefer historical figures. That category took a solid 49.2% of votes alone. With the spring semester around the corner, perhaps some favorite living faces will make an appearance too. For OTV News, I'm Katie Guile.
Are you a Leonardo DiCaprio fan? Well, the movie J. Edgar, starring DiCaprio, has hit theaters. Our movie critic Sean Collado took a closer look to bring you the scoop.
When morals decline and good men do nothing, evil flourishes. A society unwilling to learn from the past is doomed. We must never forget our history. We must never lower our guard.
Edgar, you will rise to be the most powerful man in the country.
Directed by Clint Eastwood, J. Edgar is a biodrama based on the career and personal life of J. Edgar Hoover, who is played by Leonardo DiCaprio, that spans over five decades. Now, J. Edgar, for those unfamiliar with the name, is the man who shaped the FBI into the institution it is today, as he was the first director only at the age of 24. Now, his career includes leading investigations, such as those on infamous gangster John Dillinger, the kidnapping of Charles Lindbergh's son, John F. Kennedy, and even Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. himself. Now, Eastwood, he's famous not only for his work as an actor, but also as a director. I mean, this is the man who has directed Million Dollar Baby, Letters from Iwo Jima, and Gran Torino, among many other films. And right away, you can tell this is an Eastwood film just by looking at it. His filming style is prominent in J. Edgar, as Eastwood focuses on what really matters in any film, the actors. DiCaprio's performance as J. Edgar is his best to date. It's this kind of portrayal of not just a character, but a real person, all the way from the mannerisms to the very essence, that separates an outstanding actor from a mediocre one. This performance has clearly earned DiCaprio the right to be nominated for an Oscar for Best Actor in a Leading Role. Also in J. Edgar, you get a really strong supporting cast to this film. You have Judi Dench, who is Edgar's mother, and you have Naomi Watts, who's Helen Gandy, Edgar's personal secretary. But the one actor to take a look at is Armie Hammer, who plays Clyde Tolson, the assistant director. He also brings out a real person, real character. Now, Hammer and DiCaprio together make a dynamic team. As both actors, they work to really show how the relationship between Edgar and Tolson evolved over these decades, as well as showing both the good moments and the bad moments of their friendship. Now, while the visual effects are pretty standard in terms of movie making today, the story is what really matters in this film. And yes, I'll admit, the way the flashbacks go into the moments of Edgar's career and his other life, it tends to be tiresome, but still, it's interesting how Eastwood juxtaposes these moments with the way the old Edgar is retelling these stories, reliving these moments. Overall, it is worth spending $10 to see at the theater on a weekend. Now, if you wanted to see J. Edgar multiple times, it is really up to your personal preference. And so, J. Edgar works itself to find somewhere earning between 3.5 to 4 stars out of 5. But if you want to say maybe put it on a scale of 10, give it a 7 out of 10. And that is our review of J. Edgar. For your OTV movie critiques, I'm Sean Collado.
We recently told you about our women's basketball team hosting elementary school day. Well, it took place this morning, and thanks to nearly 2,800 kids dancing in the crowd, the Lady Ospreys were encouraged going into their second half of the game against Savannah State. Now, I'll hand it over to our sports anchor, Josh Brannick, to let you know the latest in sports news. Josh, fill us in on the rest of the game and what's going on this weekend.
All right, will do, Chelsea. The women's basketball team lost to Savannah State today, 64-61. And on Tuesday, the team dropped a turnover-ridden game 76-41 to USF. In the game, the team had 23 turnovers, which turned into 31 points for the Bulls. The team is currently 0-3 and will play again on Sunday at Missouri at 3 p.m. The women's volleyball team will begin their fight for the A-Sun Conference Championship today as they face Florida Gulf Coast at 6 p.m. The team played each other just 6 days ago when FGCU beat the Ospreys in a 5-set heartbreaker 3-2. If the Ospreys win today, they will play host school Lipscomb on Friday at 6 p.m. And if they win that game, they will play in the championship game at 4 p.m. on Saturday. The men's basketball team will be starting a three-game road stint tonight as they travel to Gainesville to take on the 7th-ranked Florida Gators at 8 p.m. The team will then travel to Miami to take on the Hurricanes on Saturday at 7 p.m. And on Monday, the team will go north as they will play the 3rd-ranked Ohio State Buckeyes at 8:30. The team is coming off of a win this past Monday over Savannah State and is currently 1-1. Staying in men's basketball, Coach Matthew Driscoll announced two big recruits who signed their letter of intent to play with UNF next year. Ponte Vedra High School star Bo Beach announced on Tuesday that he will play with the Ospreys, and Georgia's DeMarcus Daniels announced his intent to play in Jacksonville yesterday. Beach posted a 28.5-point average in his junior year, and Daniels was named an honorable mention for Class A All-State honors. The two will join local standout Cameron Naylor in the 2012-2013 signing class. The women's swimming and diving team will participate in the Highlands Invitational starting today and stretching through Saturday. The Invitational is the final meet of the 2011 for the team. UNF men's hockey will look to continue their dominant season this weekend as they take on FIT. Earlier in the season, the team manhandled FIT in a two-game sweep. They will play on Friday at 9:45 p.m. at the Jack's Ice and Sportsplex and will play at FIT on Saturday. The team is currently 13-2. UNF men's golf team is earning higher respect in the collegiate golf world as they were ranked in the top 10 in two different polls this week. The team was ranked 5th by Golf Week and 7th by Golf Stat. Junior Sean Dale is also being recognized for his strong fall season as he was ranked 9th by Golf Week. The Jacksonville Jaguars will take their 3-6 record up north to Ohio Sunday to take on the 3-6 Cleveland Browns at 1 o'clock in a showdown of two struggling teams. University of Florida Gators will look to gain bowl eligibility on Saturday as they play Furman at 1 o'clock. The University of Miami Hurricanes will take on the University of South Florida in Tampa at 3:30, and the 25th-ranked Florida State Seminoles will play Virginia under the lights at 7:30 p.m. And Duke Blue Devils men's basketball head coach Mike Krzyzewski beat Michigan State on Tuesday to become the most winningest coach in Division I basketball history. With 903 wins, he surpassed former Indiana head coach Bob Knight. It was great seeing a legend just continue to grow up there in Duke.
Absolutely. That's incredible. Thank you, Josh. No problem. Well, Ospreys, that's all the news we have for you tonight. Don't forget, you can check us out at any time on OspreyTV.com and on campus on Channel 170. Have a safe weekend, and we'll see you Tuesday.